She's the coordinator of the North Shore Restorative Justice Society, which responds to needs in North and West Vancouver. She's applying restorative philosophy and practice to not only criminal justice issues, but also neighborhood disputes, seniors' problems, and illegal graffiti. So thank you, Alana.
So the questions that we were asked to consider, which was great to have those in advance to give it some thought, when I think of restorative justice, I think of. And I guess the first word that came to my mind was opportunity. When I think of restorative justice, I think of creating safe spaces to have difficult conversations. When I think of restorative justice, I think of healing, hope, unconditional love, strengthening our community and our relationships with each other. I think of building community capacity. I think of ownership and accountability. And I think of being human. And so the second question we were asked to consider was, what are the opportunities? Well, with restorative justice and community, I think the opportunities are limitless. In our program on the North Shore, we've seen huge opportunities arise, particularly in the last couple of years now, around applying restorative approaches in cases of adult abuse and neglect. We've seen the huge healing potential to bring families together in the aftermath of harm, to talk about what's happened, to have a process that allows them to come together in a very different way, to have those conversations, to avoid bringing in professionals and justice professionals into their life. We've had a huge interest from schools on the North Shore, particularly elementary schools, and that's been interesting to be around those tables, having those conversations with the parent advisory councils and some of the students and the staff around what might this look like in our school community. I think there's huge opportunity in bringing people together around situations that have created some serious harm. In the early days, I know for our program, we were dealing with a lot of minor offenses. I've seen the great healing power in bringing people together once there has been quite a serious impact. And what I've come to learn is it's not as important what the offense was, but really the impact that it had on the person. And so for the same type of offense, we can see 15 or 17 different impacts depending on the person. So to have that individualized approach to each case is a huge opportunity. But this isn't without challenges, and some of the challenges that I've seen and face, I feel, every day in our program and the various initiatives that I'm involved in prison, inside and outside institutions, inside and outside, working alongside the criminal justice system, I think that we need to do a better job understanding victimization and trauma, particularly with our programs that have been so youth-focused. Sometimes we can tend to forget about the adult victim, and we need to be mindful of that. Some of the challenges I see are still way too many people being caught up in our criminal justice system. These people come from communities that have programs and people that are willing to help, willing to accompany them through their process, but yet they are still being put through a very stigmatizing and harmful system, in my mind. So I think we need to do a better job in engaging with our community services and programs, restorative justice and others, to be able to support these people rather than funneling them through the justice system. I'm also concerned about sustainability. I think that I'm learning more and more rural programs are sustained by one or two really excited and passionate people, and I'm worried about that. I think that we need to widen the circle of people that are involved in some of the smaller programs and support each other, and I think this conference is an amazing opportunity to do that. I worry about another challenge is restorative justice being implemented in a way that jeopardizes the key values of voluntariness and community involvement and one of the key principles we hold dear, which is do no further harm. What I've noticed particularly is when restorative approaches get intertwined with institutions and bureaucracies, that some of the values tend to be sacrificed in the name of processing cases in a timely way, for example. I think it's really important that we evaluate ourselves based on the values that we identified when we started up as a grassroots program. So then the other challenge is how to be inclusive in the face of that. How do we be inclusive of other stakeholders like the police and other people in the justice system? Sometimes when we include professionals in our processes, again, we can result in outcomes that might be away from the human spirit of the work. So I still have that question of what does inclusion look like? What does true collaboration look like when we're dealing with some of the bigger institutions, like schools or the justice system? And I think that finally, one of our challenges is to really, truly understand restorative justice as being radically different than what we've sort of done before. And I think all of us have to continue to challenge ourselves personally, to be personally accountable to the values that we espouse, and to understand the insidious ways often that punishment and our judgments can sort of creep in. When I ask my students where we punish, they're quick to identify it's not just the justice system. It's in our homes, it's in our schools, it's in our relationships, and we need to understand and challenge that very assumption in order to move forward in a good way.